So, hello. So, thank you for the organizers for inviting me. So, I wanted to present you some work I did with Pascal Poirant and Natacha Portier in Lyon. Seems strange, no? It's okay. It's okay. So, the title is On the Intersection of a Sparse Curve and a Low Degree Curve. This is a polynomial version of the loss theorem. So exactly what we want to bound the number of roots, or particular roots, of some particular polynomial system. And first, very basic things, if you want to count the number of complex roots, and you have a polynomial of degree d, we know the number of roots is exactly d. So here, it is a case for complex roots, but what happened for real roots? For real roots, for example, here, we have a polynomial of degree d and one of degree 200, and the number of real roots is always 2. And in fact, there is something which is known Descartes proved it some centuries before. It is, for the real roots, we can consider the parameter which is the number of monomials, which we call the sparsity. And here, so the sparsity is 2 and 2. And in fact, there is a result, which we call the Descartes estimate, which states that if we have a polynomial which has only t monomials, then the number of real positive roots will be at most t minus 1. And in fact, if we want to count the number of real roots, it will be at most 2t minus 1. So in fact, this result is generally famous by Descartes' rule of signs, but yeah. It's Descartes' rule of sign is more precise. So here it was for one polynomial. But what happens now if you want to consider a system of polynomials? So if we consider the complex case, we have a system of n equations, for example, n variate. And if the system is non-degenerate, there is a Bézout theorem, such that the number of complex solutions will be, at most, the product of the degrees. Is it possible to do something similar for real roots and sparse system? If now we have a system such that f1 is t1 sparse until fn is tn sparse, is it possible to count the number of real solutions of this system? So this question was asked by Kushner and Co. in 1977. Is there a function which only depends on t1 until tn, which bounds the number of roots of the system, and what is if it exists, what is the optimal bound for this system?
What would these t's be?
Sorry?
What are these t's?
The t are the sparsity of the function. So we assume we have a system f1 is t1 sparse, f2 is t2 sparse.
That fn means they have t1 terms in them.
Yeah. And what I call sparsity is the number of monomials, number of terms. And so, there exists a bound which only depends on the sparsity and not at all on the degree. There was an initial case by Sebastian Hoff. He tried to solve the previous question. And in fact, it is, if we have a basic case, we have a system with only two polynomials, which are bivariate polynomials, so that the first polynomial, we know it is the degree is bounded by D. And the second polynomial, the number of terms, is bounded by t. Is it possible to find a bound which depends only on d and t, which bounds the number of real solutions for the system? In fact, according to Kushner and Co., Sebastian Hoft proved the existence of such a function. Sadly, he died some time after, and the proof was lost. But in fact, Rovensky, a few years after, proved something which is more general. He achieved with, if we have a system, in fact, his proof is something for more general of just a system of polynomial equation, but if you have a system of polynomial equation in particular, and if the number of distinct monomials is small, then it's possible to find a bound, which is here, which bounds the number of real solution of your system.
What does positive mean for the n variables?
Sorry?
What does positive mean for the n variable case?
Positive, it means each coordinate is positive.
Yeah, Oskold points out that he was inspired by Sebastian Ostero. That this really, that led him to, that's what got him going on this.
a problem.
Published this proof? As far as we know, it's not published.
It's lost.
And it's really lost. Yeah.
And in particular, so yeah, so it answers to the question by Kushner and Co. In fact, there exists a bond. So the first question, for example, this bond. In fact, in the case of a system of polynomials, case we are interested, there is an improvement by Bihan and Sotile, so that if you have the same system of n equation and n variables, and the number of distinct monomials is small, then we can get a bond which is now just exponential in L square, and before it was exponential in L plus n square. So an improvement in the exponent. So here, I point to before the general system, but what happened about if we take the problem in the other direction, what are we able to do for small system, for particular cases? And for example, if we have a trinomial, F is a trinomial and G is T sparse, there is a result by Lee, Roras, and Wong, so that the number of real solution is at most 2T minus 2. And in fact, they generalize this result in the case where we have one polynomial which is T sparse, and other polynomials are dense, are of small degree. Other polynomials are trinomials. And in this case, the number of positive real roots will be a function on n to the t. In fact, first, we improve the first result by proving that if we have a polynomial which is a trinomial and another polynomial which is T sparse, is it possible to bound the number of real positive real solution of the system by a polynomial in T cube. In fact, we improve the previous result to get the case introduced by Sébastien Neuf. If we have a polynomial F, which is non-zero, but which is of degree at most D, and if G is T-sparse, and if we want to bound the number of real roots, real solution of such a system, we are able to get a polynomial bond for the number of solutions, of real solutions. So the previous bond was given by the result by Bihan and Sotile. And in fact, the constraint that F is not the zero polynomial is important because if it is the case, we are not able to solve this problem. So I said you, what we prove it is if we have a system such that F is of degree D and G is T sparse, we are able to get a polynomial number of a real solution. But what here I hide what happens about if the case is degenerate or not. What are my assumptions? But in fact, we have the strongest result for this problem. In fact, we are able to count the number of real connected components. For example, if you have this set of zeros, we will get, we count two, and we have a bound on both this number. So first, I wanted to introduce how we are able to prove something like that. And first, the idea is we can strengthen the hypothesis. We can add some hypothesis. And we add the hypothesis that the polynomial F is irreducible. And we add the hypothesis that the number of solutions is finite. So why we are able to do that? We suppose we are able to prove the lemma how we can prove the theorem. So maybe in the lemma we have these two hypotheses, and maybe they are wrong when we want to use the theorem. So first, if the number of solutions is infinite, in fact, it means that F is irreducible, so F divided G. So we just have to search the number, to bound the number of zero of F, which is of small degree, and this is known before. And there is a bound, D times D minus 1, this is a result by, it's a generalization of Dezu's theorem by Tom, Petrovsky.
Petrovsky and Tom. Yeah.
Sorry. And the second point, it is maybe F is not irreducible. So what the T, it means that F is a product of irreducible factor F1 until Fk, and we just want to bound the number of real roots of such a system, and after we'll get all the real roots. So we have this problem. What we want, in fact, the idea is first we have F equals 0. We want to transform this equation into Y equals a nice function of H. And after, we can reinject this function into G xy equals 0. And we will get a small of nice function equals 0. And after, we want to bound the number of real roots of such a sum. So for the first step, we want to consider the solution of f of xy equals 0. And for that, we will use the cylindrical algebraic decomposition. So we have the set of the zeros. We can cut the real line for the x-coordinate into different intervals. So that on each interval, there are some function y equal a nice function of h. What can we say? We can say, in fact, it's possible to show that the number of intervals is at most d square, minus d, and the number of function on each interval is at most d. So if we just want a polynomial bound, we can consider just the intersection of each part, each such a function, and a g, and we multiply at the end by d cube. If you want to get the bound we announced before, we need to be a bit more precautionary. And now we want to bound the number of roots of such a sum.
With h of x is a semi-algebraic function, it's not polynomial. The algebraic function.
Yeah. So we, and for bounding the number of roots of such a function, not a polynomial, because h is not a polynomial anymore, we will use the Wronskian. So in fact, Wronskian was already used for proving some result like that. For example, Pouliot-Jagger and Jagger used it for proving for reproving another proof for Descartes' rule. There were some connection with before with the number of roots, which was introduced by Vourov and van der Porten. And for example, so what is the Wronskian? The Wronskian, it is you have a family of function, k function, which are sufficiently differentiable on an interval I. And you take a matrix, you put all your function in the first line. In the second line, you put the first derivative of your function, and so on, until the last line is the k minus 1 derivative of your function. You take at the end the determinant of this matrix, you will get the Wronskian of this family. And so the idea is we want to upper bound the number of roots of a sum by the number of roots of some particular Wronskian. So here, in the basic case, what happens? If you have a I in an interval, and we have these Wronskians, this family of Wronskian, and we assume, first, we have no zero on I. This Wronskian really does not have zero. And then we can prove that the number of zero of this sum is smaller than k minus 1. So in fact, we can prove it by induction. We can verify for check for k equals 1, but it's more interesting k equals 2. So if you have f1 plus f2, you can put f1 in factor. You get 1 plus f2 over f1 in the parenthesis. In fact, you know f1 is exactly Wronskian on f1. So by hypothesis, f1 does not have 0. So you just need to search the 0 of this parenthesis. You take the derivative of this parenthesis, and you will get, in fact, exactly Wronskian of f1 f2 divided by f1 squared. By assumption, this does not have 0. By a rule, by a Rolle's theorem, it means that before the number of roots is at most 1. Number of roots of this parenthesis is at most 1. Okay. Now, if you have a sum of size p, you do the same. You put f1 factor. You have this sum. The idea you want to use, you want to derivate this parenthesis. After the after when you derivate, you will get a sum of p minus 1 function. So we want to use your induction hypothesis. But in fact, your induction hypothesis, the assumptions are about the Wronskian of the Fi. But something, in fact, we can show. It is if you consider now the Wronskian of the family F2 divided by F1 prime and so on until Fq F1 prime. In fact, it is exactly the Wronskian of F1 until Fq times 1 divided by F1 to the P. So in fact, you can derivate and use your induction hypothesis. So in particular, the number of Wronskian of this sum is bounded by k minus 1.
So what is Q? Is Q the same thing as P?
No.
No.
Ah.
Q.
Yeah, it's Q.
P is Q.
Yeah, it's Q. Sorry. Yeah. So first is always the same. If you just want, you just search for a polynomial bound, you can say we search the zero of these Wronskians. You consider just these cases, which are the few cases, and now you check on each interval between two roots. You count the number of intersections. And you get a point. In fact, if you want something which is more precise, we can get exactly if you need to check each root are already counted or not, that the number of zero of a sum of size k is smaller than k minus 1 plus 2 times the sum of the number of the zero of each one of these Wronskians. So what remains to be done, if we come back to our outline? So we have rewritten f equals 0 into y equals a nice function of x. We have bounded the number of roots of this sum by the number of roots of some particular Wronskians. So we just need to bound the number of real roots of this family of Wronskians. So we just want to bound the number of roots of these Wronskians. In fact, the idea it is why it was interesting to use the Wronskian. It is now the Wronskian. We can easily factorize some part in the column or in the line. So, for example, here, if we consider the case where we are n equals 3, so we have each monomial which are of the form x to the exponent, h to the exponent. So, and now, when we derivate, in fact, we can see we can get something, a big part and factor, because at each time we can just touch the exponent by one element. So we can put for the first column to all the x to the alpha 1 minus 2, h to the beta 1 minus 2 in factor, and do the same for each column. And at the end, we have a big term in factor, but and a determinant of some nice function of small degrees. So the number of roots of this is just the root of x, the root of h. And the number of roots of this, it is just a small polynomial in x and h. And so if we do the computation, you can get, in fact, the number of connected components will be, at most, this polynomial in D and T. Now, what are the perspectives? So yeah, it was Sebastian's problem, but is it possible to extend this result to generalize this result? So the first idea it is if you have one polynomial g which is sparse and other polynomial f1 until fn which are dense. And in fact, with Moab, Safieldin, Pascal Coirant et Achapartier, we need to finish the proof, but it seems almost done. Another problem it is. So here, I think it's harder. It is what happens if we have f which is sparse and g which is sparse. Yeah, I have just to the question, to the system. And in fact, this corresponds to the case where f equals 0, and we just want g is a bivariate and sparse. The case before I said the constraint f non-zero was important. In fact, otherwise, we are in this case.
Why isn't this Kowalski's theorem?
Why is the relation between?
I mean, why isn't this Kowalski? If f and g are both parse, then Kowalski's theorem.
Yeah, But we have always the bound which is exponential on the sparsity, and always the idea is to search, is it possible to find a polynomial bound?
Yeah, the bound in this case, I mean, you get from Clonsky's theorem, is just wrong, just too big. They have different supports. If they had the same support, it wouldn't be so bad, but having different supports is crazy. I think that's...
Would we be happy you could bound the number of connected components instead of the sparsity of F?
It's still exponential. It's still exponential, actually. Could you explain how both of them sparse correspond to F0, the other sparse?
Because if we are able to do F equals 0 and G is sparse, what happens? And if we have a system like that, we can put F squared plus G squared, and you try to search which are the solution, and it will be exactly the solution of the system. And so here, we're able to bound the number of solutions for such a system, but now, is it possible to do something with such a solution? It's possible to counting them, for detecting them, or something like that? We don't know. I wanted to give you one motivation. First, when I was introduced to this problem, it was by a conjecture by Pascal Poiron, such that if we have a particular family of polynomial, which is the sum of product of sparse polynomial, is it possible to show that all these polynomials, the number of real roots, is polynomials in these parameters? And in fact, what is interesting with this real to conjecture, it is that it implies lower bound for the size of arithmetic circuits for the permanent. And so I wanted to finish by with some stupid problem. If you want to play, if you have two polynomials, F and G, which are T-sparse, so F, number of real roots, is at most 2T minus 1. For G, it's the same. It's just Descartes' estimate. If we take the product, the number of real roots will be at most, it will be either the roots of F, either the root of G, and you can count, in fact, the number of real roots will be at most 40 minus 3. And now we consider FG plus 1. So in fact, it's the basic case of this. It's a sum of products of sparse polynomials. What is the number of real roots? If we expand the product and we count the number of terms, we can get a bound which is 2 times T squared minus 1. But before, it was linear in T, and now we are quadratic in T. And we don't know if there exists or not a bound which is linear in T, or something somewhere between linear and quadratic. Thank you.
Questions?
Toy problem, does it have any application to the other bivariate case or any other? Or is...
Not directly, but maybe we hope that if we are able to get a non-trivial argument here, or something which is linear, to do the same after, to do the same with plus x, something like that, and to get something which is non-trivial for this problem. The idea is to find a tool for this problem, and just with this basic case, we are stuck. So maybe a tool for this basic case, we hope, could be generalized for...
So isn't the case that this last question arose, you didn't think this up in a room without windows, somebody asked you this question, isn't that... Someone mentioned this.
Pascal? Yeah. So I don't know exactly who you cite someone in your paper for.
You mean for FG plus 1?
Well, yeah.
Oh, okay. So I asked this general question, and then we looked at various cases. Like, for instance, you can look at F1 times F2 times Fm plus 1. M-fold product. You can ask whether there's a bound that is polynomial in M in the standard product. Someone pointed out that even for two-fold product, it's not known. So this was observed by Arkady Shadow-Palais that even for if you have a product of two polynomials, it's not obvious what the optimal bound is.
It seems to be a serious stepping stone. I mean, if you can get that one, it seems that you should be able to get more. And a comment on this: if you look at this tropically, then there's some motivation. So if you look at this over the p-adics, or if you look at over the reals, then under some combinatorial assumptions, then it seems like there might be a linear bound. But you know, something being true tropically does not mean it's true for in the real world.
Tropically just means it's true in a very extreme sense.
Yes, exactly. So it's true in extreme
sense.
Not
extreme ones, but
yeah,
hard ones.
Yeah, that's exactly the problem.
Another question? Okay, so then we stop here. Thank you. Next.